Welcome to the Rebel Love Show. We are a once a week broadcast from Manchester, New Hampshire, where we are pro pots, pro gun, and pro coffee. You can find all of our content at rebelloveshow.com. I am Ron Mathias.
And I am the Rebel Mistress. And I'm going to get really drunk on this show, guys.
It's going to be a good show. And today we have in studio none other than Mateus and Allie. How's it going, kids?
Hey, guys. Doing great.
How was Montreal? You guys left the country.
Yes, my first time in Canada. We went on vacation.
That was your first time?
Mm-hmm. Oh, nice. My first time in Canada.
I should have asked Mateus to bring back my cookies then. That's why you couldn't find them.
Well, we searched high and low for them. It's just, you know.
Rob doesn't even. I asked him to bring me back maple leaf cookies because they stopped selling them at Trader Joe's and they only have them in Canada now.
And they're for you? You just like the way they taste?
Yeah, I love them.
I've never had them before.
I don't remember how they even tasted.
Oh, I love those things. But anyway, so your first time in Canada, how was Border Patrol?
Yeah, did you pull Mark Edge?
Don't even get me started on Border Control. It was a nightmare going into Canada, not coming back for some reason.
Yeah, coming back into the States was surprisingly easy.
We're just like, can you speak English? Good. Okay, good.
Some of the people who were rooming with us did have a problem coming back. And I understand that that's typically how it goes, is that it's easy to get into Canada, but it's hard to come back. Or someone implied that recently. So
maybe.
I don't know. That wasn't our experience.
Not for us.
Why was it hard for them?
Yeah, why is it hard?
I don't know what the holdup was for them.
Was this a free stater trip?
It was consisted of us, yeah.
Oh, okay. Maybe they just tried to cop block Border Patrol as they went
by. I don't know, maybe.
Yeah. So I could tell you the story. We pull up and Mateus is like, okay, we got about 2 minutes before we get to the border. And I was like, oh, okay. And then as we started closer, I was like, should I be filming this? And then so I decided to film it.
The answer to that is yes.
Well, I had my camera out and I was filming, just like, you know, just keeping a record for my seat. I wasn't like, you know, wasn't in his face or anything like that. And when we get up there, he asks us a couple questions.
What were the questions?
Oh, I mean, I could kind of give you an idea, but it's just like what you would expect. It's like,
where are you going? How long are you staying?
Yeah,
I've never left the United States.
Where do you live?
I don't even have a passport,
so I don't know what they ask.
Are you bringing weapons? Are you bringing $10,000 in cash?
You should just say yes to everything. Yes, yes to everything.
Well, look, okay, so yeah, I mean, it's one of those weird situations where if you're getting pulled over, like minding your own business and getting pulled over, then it's sort of a different thing because it's like there's only so many options. You just want to like go on your way, just like we did. But I'm just saying that clearly they can say, well, if you're not going to answer our questions or let us do our thing, then you don't get to go into Canada. And we wanted to go to Canada because we had this whole trip planned, obviously. So we're just like trying to get through. And I was filming and the police officer had asked me a question, and then I guess not a police officer but Border Patrol agent asked me a question, and then he was like, why are you filming me? And I said, well, it's my first time in Canada, so I just wanted to make a little video, which is true. I've been filming a lot of the ride up there.
Yeah.
And
normal people do that, by the way. Normal people,
I think it seems normal.
When they go on vacation or even when they're out with friends, know what they do? They fucking film and like they take video and pictures. Yeah. That's why there's Vines and Snapchats. Like people actually video.
There's nothing threatening about that. And so yeah. And then so he said he asked me to turn it off. And I was like, well, am I required to turn it off? And he was like, what did you say? And I was like, I just want to know if I'm required to turn it off. And he goes, it's for my security. And I'm like, so I just want to be clear. It's for you. You just personally want me to turn it off. If that's the case, then fine. And so I turned it off. And then, of course, they become total dicks. It was like, yeah, make you glad you turned off your camera. Because after that, he told us to turn into like secondary checking, where they like check you more thoroughly, and
that's what I would have turned the camera back on.
Well, like, yeah, it was tempting, but considering how they reacted the first time, it made me I was just very nervous.
It's just
a
question of being prudent. Like, we're trying to get into Canada, we've got a lot on the line. This is not like an activist like cop lock trip. Like, if you want to take a day and do this and you have nothing planned that day,
but no, I mean, that's
fun, go for it.
That's the thing, is that like, if they were going to go easier on us for me turning off the camera, which is what I kind of like, I thought
but
that maybe turning off the camera meant, okay, well, whatever, just like, you know, that's over with. But
right,
no,
but it wasn't.
I don't know if that's why they did this, but it kind of seems like they just didn't like that. And
I mean, I just feel like
I don't know why else they would have asked us.
Like, yes, you want to go to Canada and you don't want to like cause trouble, and I'm all for that. And I hate talking to cops, but then at the same time, like, just like them asking you to turn your camera off and just like feeling the need to ask you, like, what did you just say to me? Like, are you my I had a problem with the principal or anyone like claiming to like be like, what did you say to me? Like, exactly what I just said. Like, don't try to intimidate me. Well, so that's my problem. Just like the bureaucrats, like, I just always want to be like, okay, I have a right to film you. And I have a right to cross this border because here's my shiny little piece of paper that I paid like $800 for to come across this imaginary line with a fence that you've built. So you know what? I'm going to continue to do that. So I just feel like it's kind of rude on their part. And that's why I'm sometimes to stand my ground against like these people who claim to be authority, because at the end of the day, I'm just like, it's one thing to like go crazy, like, and go whole Keniac on them, but then it's another thing to be smart. I'm like, no, I'm not.
Well, the thing is,
if
they're not even going to stop being dicks when you stop filming, then it's like, well, I should have just filmed you the whole time, because clearly the way you answered wasn't, yes, you're required to not film. No filming. See the sign? There was nothing like that. It was, his answer was clearly,
this was a Canadian
agent. You can't back down.
Yeah, this is trying to get in. So, yeah. And then, so we go into secondary. And then these two other Border Patrol agents come up, roll up on us, like, you know, just straight up like cop thugs. There might have been a couple more questions that they asked. And then it was like, get out of the car. We're going to search it.
Newbie 66 wants you to come to his party dressed as a sexy police officer and handcuff him.
It's not the first time that I've come to a party as a police officer and handcuffed people.
Really?
I did that my first Pork Fest.
You dressed as a police officer?
I dressed.
Where
it wasn't
are these
very
pictures?
Sexy.
I have never seen these pictures.
I'll show them to you.
I need these photos.
I just had a shirt on that said FBI and a cop hat and some handcuffs that came with a costume.
Well, that's pretty hot.
And I arrested Adam from Cop Block.
That's pretty hot.
I can't think of his last name.
Levine?
Anyway.
No.
You're thinking of Ademo?
Ademo. Thank you. Ademo Freeman. Yeah. That's his last name, of course. I could just guess Freedom from now on.
No. Yeah, Freeman. Pro tips or whatever, props to you for filming in the first place. So
yeah, I mean, I feel kind of like bad about having given up on the filming. I feel like, what's the point of doing it if you're just going to be like, okay, officer, I'll turn it off then, since you asked so nicely. But whatever.
Next time you'll be more prepared. Your second time in Canada, you'll know the drill.
So that's not even what got crazy. What got crazy is when they started searching our vehicle, and it was my car, and they knew that, and they find a little pepper spray thing that I thought I lost. Like, I've been looking for this thing because I would like to carry that around with me when I walk around in Manchester.
Oh, shit,
I can't tell you how many times, like, since I moved here, I've been like, I wish I had that damn pepper spray. Yeah. Where is that?
I got a little knife.
So thanks for the Canadian Border Patrol for finding it for me. But
I hope
they didn't like it very much.
Border Patrol doesn't find the blunt we lost in our trunk.
Apparently,
right?
Pepper spray is illegal in Canada.
Oh. No shit.
Unless you're using it a certain type against bears. I think there's like a bear mace.
There's a bear clause in Canada in regards to pepper spray.
Yeah, you're not allowed to use pepper spray in self-defense in Canada.
Unless it's a bear.
It's a certain type, but otherwise it's a banned weapon according to their laws. So,
you better believe that, like, if I lived in Canada, I would just be buying bear mace to use against people.
That's the incentive.
Isn't that exact thing
and
called
then,
bear mace?
And then that's the, yeah. And then that would be like, if the whole point is to try to protect assailants who you would pepper spray, like bear mace is going to be worse, so
yeah.
They're not really helping anybody on that.
Well, more bear mace, Border Patrol, and everything else when we come back. And I also made some beautiful drinks for the studio tonight. Mm-hmm. They don't know how strong they are. Not yet,
oh,
anyway.
They'll know soon.
Radio is the most personal of mediums. I exist right now in your head. If you listen to Free Talk Live regularly, you know me. Free Talk Live is on more than 160 radio stations around the U.S. and has been downloaded on every continent around the world. Hundreds of thousands of listeners.
But I don't really like muting the mics that often during a show unless we're talking about something that's off the table. I don't even mute it during the bumpers. I hate it going into the fucking bumpers.
Website or idea. Email me, Mark.
What? Freetalklive.com. Since time began. Oh, I know. I was going to say, thank God for looking. It's in my coat. It's in my coat, babe. You need to put that one on. I was waiting. I know. Oh, my God. If I say the exact same thing that she says, six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a can I not back you up on it? Can I not back you up on something without you being upset? What do you think of like taking credit for what you're saying or something?
No, it's not a chance to push people around. Oh, sorry, let me turn it off. The drug war is nothing but a
farce. It's not as nice as yours. Yours isn't a lot nicer.
Yeah, it really cuts out a lot, and like this screen is like blobby. Like I have to press it back in.
Guns and weed. Sounds like I looked at all the reviews online. That's
guns and weed. Perfect gift.
Oh, we got a Skype caller
soon. Oh, shit.
The three most well, I'm bringing it back. You can do
for LRN. Sure, it's your turn, babe. One, let your friends know you're listening. End of story. Okay.
And so we're allowed to smoke cigarettes in here?
Yeah.
Can I have one?
Yeah.
That's the only rule.
Well, can I have one too? I'll give you. I'll buy one off of you.
Is that I'm running low, so I think so.
No, if you're running low, I don't want to take it.
Well, I'll still take it and me and Rob can share.
See, there we go. Same great prices, and LRN gets a cut. Please do your online shopping at
shop.lrn.fm. Rob, you were such a cute kitty.
When my mother was diagnosed with glaucoma, her
conservative, I don't think she's as cute as Benny.
Well, she has a scratch on Benny was trying to do that to my laptop screen.
What?
Yes, I think she has the mirror, which is Ash doesn't have any claws, that's why. She doesn't scratch any. I would if I could. Yeah, she tries to scratch Riker, and Riker's like, you must want to play with me. Why else would you be hitting me on the face with your soft, soft paws? Oh, it's cute that Benny was. If you stop petting her, why is this not showing? Just like this happen
all the time. That was funny. But they don't. Excuse me. I think she thought we were like a single thing. Because like you were petting her, but she was getting.
The chat said that this is what.
So I think maybe she thought like, wow, this is like giant, like human mass.
That's
you
weird.
Have to create your own username and stuff.
It's broadcasting right now. I don't understand why they can't see it.
It's not showing up.
Did you know you can get news updates about what's happening? Can I just
make the
username Allie and his?
You can sign up.
Yeah,
sure.
You can order updates.lrn.fm.
Plus, you can stay in the loop by joining our
Facebook
profile.
I
want
his name associated with facebook.lrn.fm
or follow us on Twitter at twitter.lrn.fm. It's all free.
What the fuck? It's supposed to be going right now.
I mean, I have friends delivered to your email box.
Facebook.lrn.fm.
Start hanging
out. It's happening land because it's your friends.
Yeah. It's not lame when they do it.
Yeah.
If there was a place that liberty-minded people
and people that aren't your friends
political positions and were rolling back government, would you move there?
So I didn't. You said that they were 20% voting block. I don't get this. I didn't see the bills. Oh, just that you were a sexy police officer and they wish you could arrest them and that would be their dream. Talk about my weekend.
You can connect to the Liberty Radio Network via our Facebook page.
You just got to hold up the picture, okay?
LRN.fm. That's Facebook.LRN.fm.
And welcome back. I was about to call this show Flaming Freedom. That's where my mind is right now, just everywhere. But welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. We're here with Mateus von Gutenberg and with the lovely Allie Havens. Sorry, hey, Mateus, you're not super lovely. You're okay.
I'm lovely in my own way.
He has his days. they're telling us about Montreal. But we have a Skype caller, actually, so we're going to ahead and see what he has to say.
Alex,
what's up there, Alex? No, he's calling.
Alex.
He's got to answer.
I did. I thought I connected to him.
Hi, Alex. Sorry, how can we help you, man?
No worries.
Hey.
How's it going?
It's going well. We're not on live, right?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
We are live right now on rebelshow.com/live.
All right, fantastic. So basically, I just wanted to tell a quick story and then ask my question. So recently, you know, I've been going on quite a few dates and whatnot, and one worked pretty well, and I got her back to my place, right? So, you know, I'm kissing on her neck. You know, she's moaning and whatever. It's getting great. But then it escalated, and I ended up having to kick her out of my house because she, you know, basically said, like, got distraught, started crying about her ex-boyfriend or whatever, and told me, you know, oh, she's got the guy.
And then I call him crying hysterically. And I go, oh, my God, I think the toaster died. And I just start, like, screaming and everything. And then he's like, oh, sorry, I got to go. But in your case, if you have a friend, you could just be like, oh, sorry, you got to go. Actually, I have an emergency I need to take care of. Like, could you please? Or you could just kindly ask her to get the fuck out of your house. It just depends on how nice or mean you want to be. But also, you need to screen people more carefully. Like, this girl has gonorrhea. And if she's, like, willing to tell you that up front, she probably would have been willing to tell you that at dinner. So.
Well, yeah, I guess I just, you know. I assumed from the other things that she was telling me that she was not going to have that. And I really would have rather her tell me that before.
Would you kill someone you have gonorrhea before you have sex with them?
Yeah, hopefully. Oh, you're asking him.
Yeah, I'm asking him. Like, Alex, would you?
Yes, for certain.
You would. Okay.
Allie and Mateus, do you have a specific way to kick a love interest or anti-love interest out of your apartment if you're no longer feeling it?
Mm.
Any advice?
I don't know. My intuition is just to be forward and direct. But in the situations where I would want to be direct, I can't help but chicken out and have to try to find some other kind of tactful, subtle way, nuanced way of doing it. So
she's not over there right now, is she?
No, no.
Like,
well, the worst. Well, the worst part was just like, I was angry, right? I was upset and kind of confused by all this information because she had said a bunch of other stuff as well. But then it was like, okay, well, now I have to walk you out and turn the lights on and unlock the door. And then, oh, you can't pull out of my driveway. So it was this long, like 10, 20 minutes ordeal.
Okay, I'm just curious about the Seinfeld context. Were you guys like drunk at the time or was she drunk?
Nope.
Did she feel bad about having gonorrhea? Did she say, you know, like, I just really want to tell you this because I feel bad about it. I'm going to get it cleaned up tomorrow. I'm getting a shot. I'm getting a penicillin. Well,
she was like, oh, I'm getting treated for it and stuff. And I was, you know, she sort of was just like, you're the exact opposite of the guy who gave it to me. He said he was going to marry me and all this stuff. And but he went off base and cheated with some Asian prostitute and stuff. And I'm just thinking to myself, well, hold on. I didn't know you were shacked up with some guy who was doing that. And yes, I am the opposite of a soldier that's going to cheat on you after lying.
Where'd you meet this girl?
I knew her from middle school and I saw her online. So I hit her up again. She was actually the first girl I had kissed back then. So I figured,
my goodness,
I figured it would go well. And it worked it went really well until it didn't.
How awesome would a girl have to be for her to be like, I have gonorrhea, can we just use a condom?
Not awesome.
She has to be really hot. I mean, she has to be like Halle Berry or something like that.
Well, I'm just looking it up because I didn't want to like be insensitive.
Wait, did she touch your penis did you touch her?
I just want to make sure
she had gonorrhea.
Nope. It's not viral, it's bacterial. So I just want to make sure that was the case. Because if like someone said they had a virus,
at least she told you before you guys.
If someone has herpes, I would never be like, well, I mean.
Well, see, that was part of the thing was that, you know, she had told me all of this. And then she's like, but, you know, I want to wait until marriage. And I was like, well.
Well, that's just even worse than gonorrhea.
Bye, Felicia.
You have a disease.
All right, the gonorrhea was one thing. Now this is like another level.
Like, I'm waiting until marriage. I just happen to have gonorrhea.
Don't be bringing women to bed if they're only going
to. Also, you need to be in the armed services. That's another catch.
Like, one of these can be treated. The other one cannot be treated.
Yeah. Well, basically, I ruined my life and made a huge mistake is what she was trying to get at. And
ruined her life with gonorrhea?
This is what you're going to do.
Well, the bad guy, I guess.
How about don't bring women that you've known for like 10 years back to your bedroom. This is what you do. You go on Tinder, maybe OKC or I don't know, go to a fucking bar. I don't know. Meet someone new, bring them home. That's my
Well, I think the best way to change your course of action is to look at what you've been doing. And I'm curious, like, you'd gone on a couple of dates with this girl and like kind of know her to some extent?
No. This is the first.
Why did she even come back to your house if she's waiting
for
marriage?
Well, then I say props to her for being so honest. Yeah. I mean, a lot of people wouldn't say anything.
Well, she should have said that before they even got to the bed.
Well, she did, right?
Did she say she had gonorrhea before you brought her home?
No.
Wait, are you saying that you had sex with her?
No.
Well, yeah, see, so she was honest.
If there was, I mean,
that's like waiting for the last possible.
She may have gonorrhea, but at least she's the kind of person who'd be honest. I don't know. I'm not saying go back and find this girl, but I'm just saying I don't want to hate on her.
Well,
for...
look, it's possible if she has this, you know, idea of waiting until marriage that she just wanted to go back, you know, to your place to make out or whatever. And if that's the case, it doesn't necessarily require bringing up that you have gonorrhea. You know, if you expect to have sex or whatever, then it's, you know, obviously.
Yeah, but
respect,
I mean,
you
it's
should,
both, right? But, it's piling both of those things on that all of a sudden
right.
turns like, oh, I'm feeling this. This is great. To, oh, well, I'm not a virgin, but I want you to wait if we get together because, you know, I've already went and messed my, you know, her quote, I've been messing my life.
Damn,
up.
Got some opportunity cost.
Her life's mistakes aren't your life's mistakes unless you really like her and you want to wait and you feel like she's like special enough for that. But she's probably not at that point.
So, Rob, I just want to make sure that I get your advice correctly. His question of how do you get this woman out of the house the best way possible? Your solution is fish in a different pond.
Well, I mean, I wouldn't be bringing them home like that if that was the case to begin with. But my advice, kick her out. Kick her to the curb if she's really lying. I don't know. Do what you got to do.
You think you should
just survive, man. You got to survive.
Just survival. Straightforward and say, look,
do what you got to survive.
Get the fuck up out of here. Bye, Felicia. That's how you answer that. Well, thank you, Alex, for calling. We'll see you next time.
Why did you move to the
show? I am like, the YouTube feed to work. Thank God. That took me, I don't know what happened. Like, it should have been working and it wasn't. I have no idea why it wasn't working.
Do this right now.
Like, literally, I had everything working fine on it.
Who got it? And once I got here, I knew there was nowhere else that I wanted to be.
I've always wanted to change the world. So I moved to the Shire to join people who were actually working towards doing the same thing.
The people here are awesome, loving, and positive. It was for the adventure.
It's
and
like, So when I ask a girl out at the clinic, I should say I'm on vacation for the next week.
To be perfectly honest, I feel bad for Alex. I was jumping into the conversation. The YouTube feed wasn't working. It was like scheduled for tomorrow or something. I don't know. So literally I had to close out the feed, bring it back up, start the broadcast, take the link, take it to log in as the administrator on the website, change the live page to the new YouTube feed, and then update that, and then throw it back into the chat. I'm doing all this while, like, I'm trying to pay attention to a Skype call. It's hard to, like, when shit hits the fan, like, during a live show, like, I'm kind of concentrating, making sure everything's looking good and going out.
433?
To be able to move to a place where other people can, like, passionately believe in free and independent. What the Free State Project is managing to do, though, is to put their money where their
Who's Wu's King?
Getting up across the country and saying, let's go someplace and let's demonstrate the power of these ideas. Mm. There's a lot of kind of philosophy.
He's been in the chat every time.
Liberty. There's a lot of thinking about it and talking about it. But here in New Hampshire, people are doing it.
Did you share the YouTube?
Yeah.
In New Hampshire, a documentary by Free State Project Early Movers. Watch it free at 101reasonsfilm.com. 101reasonsfilm.com.
This Your Family Today tip is brought
to you. I hate running a show. It's like annoying as fuck. Better
by providing a zero calorie alternative to sugary drinks. Visit us at nestle-purelife.us.
Her bio picture.
They often don't want to stop.
I don't give a fuck.
I don't want to criticize. So send them out with a bottle of water
and encourage them to listen. I've been asking her, like, you think she's more organized, but like, I've been asking her to send me her bio for like a week and a half.
Why do you want her bio?
I need it for
Imagine someone in your
community getting in there. Is she gonna be a regular co-host?
Rotating.
No shit. Why would this is information I should know as your producer, babe? Become your producer. I'd like to know who's a co-host of your show.
Well, there's a lot of co-hosts.
I understand that. You don't. This is communication. You should be talking to me about your show.
Mainly, she's gonna be on for Liberty Forum, so that's what I mean by him. It's gonna be three ladies in leather.
That's gonna be really gonna be wearing leather.
Yeah.
Holy shit. Broadcast.lrn.fm. You can't win. I'm gonna definitely be there to watch that show.
Improve your
chances of winning. We'll
recording during the day.
Sorry. So Flaming Freedom's, we'll talk about, we are going to talk about it at some point during the live broadcast. You know, this is a live broadcast, you know, it's on YouTube. Friday is Flaming Freedom in the afternoon, then Saturday is Rebel Up Show in the afternoon.
Other perfectly flat entry blanks. And if they don't spin the drum and merely reach into a box full of other perfectly flat entry blanks,
yeah,
many of which are sticking together.
We're going to be broadcasting from the Radisson. We're not going to be here.
Reaching in.
Liberty Forum. Like, why wouldn't I broadcast from Liberty Forum?
Yeah. Why is this the banner?
I just wanted to pick a photo, a stock photo of the of a studio or of the of something. I was trying to look for a good photo shot of Mateus and Haley.
Well.
And I was on a time crunch. It's not free for us. You can help us cover our satellite costs with the chip in on the right side of the page at
lrn.fm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because
and we are back here on LRN.FM. We're also broadcasting on IPM Nation. If you are listening on either one of those stations, check out rebelloveshow.com/live and you can watch our YouTube feed and interact in the chat. I know I had the feed not work for some reason earlier today. Well, hey, I fixed it in the last segment. So.
And also, I don't know if you, did you say Skype us? Skype us. We want to talk to you with the relationship.
Any relationship question you have, bring it to us.
Well, that last one with Alex was
relationship, anarchy, whatever you want to talk about, we're down for Skype us on Rebel Love Show. So we didn't even get to like how our weeks were. We talked about Ellie and Mateus in Montreal, but it was Monday was Rob's two years
in the Shire was yesterday.
Wow! Congratulations!
Third year student now.
I know. I'm coming. I'm now a junior. I guess you can say.
A junior in Liberty.
Yeah, it feels like I've been here like six fucking years.
So I gotta say, it feels like I'm in high school.
It feels like it. Oh, it is very clicky.
I get that.
But no, it feels like I've been
wait till you're a senior.
A senior?
Wait till you're a senior.
Allie's an alum.
No, she's not. She left, so she came back. So then you start over.
You're held back.
Yeah, you were held back.
You just skipped class for like 6 months.
Yeah.
Wait, how long have you actually been here, like, all together?
If you don't count the times when I left, then since 2011, so...
Damn, 2011.
Wow, yeah. So you've been here for like 25 years.
Yeah,
you got 3 years out of me. Jesus, that's a hell of a long time.
I haven't even been here for like I've been here a year, just a year in December. So
I know
literally
our move
just
dates
like
are very close. They're only like a month apart from each other.
Yeah, but like a year difference. So it's like I feel like I've been here for like 60 years too, even though it's been a year.
Yeah,
like I can't even remember parts of my life before, mostly because I was on a lot of drugs.
But you're on a lot of drugs now.
Yeah, I was thinking like,
what would it be back then?
What happened yesterday? I don't know. Like, we can't answer these questions, guys. Too much going on. But so since it was his 2 year anniversary, and I'm the best wife ever, and
she's a queen wifey.
He's, I don't know, he's just horrible.
What the fuck are you talking about? How, pissing you off? You know, you are so ungrateful of who I am as a human being, babe.
Wow, that's gonna be a problem.
Yeah.
Imagine if you had like someone that wasn't me.
That's a serious.
Imagine you didn't have me.
Yeah.
Imagine what you'd have the shit you'd have to be dealing with.
Yeah, all those guys, small penises. Anywho, so it was his 2 year anniversary.
2 years.
So I had to make a special, and I had already ordered him a deep dish Chicago, a deep dish style pizza from Chicago. Yeah, so- but I ordered two. So we were actually gonna make. I made that for him. And that's this drink that you guys are all drinking, warming you up down
delicious.
There.
Delicious.
You got to hold it up. Hold up the drink cover. I made a drunken love from Tipsy Bartender. It is fucking great.
It's pretty strong.
Yeah, it's pretty strong. And then we took a bubble bath.
Oh,
that was romantic.
It was. Sweet. It very was.
Even though the water was cold, but it was okay. It was like swimming. And we did some MDMA in the bathroom.
It's not an anniversary if we don't do some MDMA.
Exactly.
That sounds nice.
And then in the morning, we went ice skating.
First time ice skating in my life.
I had to force him to go ice skating. All the women there were like, oh my God, you got him to come ice skating with you.
Yeah, I was impressing all the women there. They're jealous that their husbands weren't there skating
with
their wives.
They're afraid to look like
stupid. I looked old and stupid skating. I have no balance
whatsoever.
What
you got to do is you got to go around the ring, like hold on to the side.
Yeah, that's
and then
did.
Eventually you just like, screw this. That's what I'm tired first, of doing this. Yeah. I'm just going to go for it. And then you fall down and you... But
he never fell. Actually, I fell. And it was funny because we were drinking this stuff because I've been making this since I made it. And we took some in the car, just like in the water bottle, because that's how we roll. And we drove to Portsmouth, like just drinking this. And like by the time we got ice skating, I was tipsy.
It seems like whenever we go out to the coast, we're usually doing like you're drinking or smoking or doing both while in a car.
Yeah, pretty much. So by the time we went ice skating, he went around a few times holding the rail. And I've been ice skating before. I like ice skating. It's just like wearing heels. I really like it. And it was a beautiful day.
Oh my God, gorgeous.
Yeah, I saw pictures. It looked really nice outside. Yeah,
well, I mean,
really
for my nice. First time, like, I know it sounds weird, just ice skating, but I've never gone ice skating. I think I haven't rollerbladed in like 12 years, 13
See,
years.
I was going to ask if you've been rollerblading because I find that they're pretty similar.
They are similar. It's just I've never... It's been. I
wouldn't have fell.
Rollerblade for like a year or two. I had rollerblades when I was like a teenager, and
yeah,
I was like, "Fuck this!" I kept falling on my face.
I don't need this. For a while, my after school program. I don't know what years, but I got to go to the skate center, which is badass. Like that's so cool that
like
my mom was like, "I'll set you
South.
Up with a skate center after school program." Like I just get to skate until she gets there. That was awesome. Cool. And so I got really good at skating.
Yeah, skating ring was like a big thing in the South. So like they had parties at the skating ring.
Yes, skate night was a big deal.
Night. Oh my God.
If I could go to
skate
night,
might
as well tell me not to go to prom because that was the night.
Skate night was the night. Okay. You wore your best outfit.
That's when you're
going to
kiss
skates.
The cute boy. Finally.
I have the cutest picture.
You run up
from
behind him and then you push him down and then you snicker as you skate away. And the next thing you know, he's going to have you in the corner. He's going to be kissing all over you.
Yeah, I remember the corner and kissing. I never pushed anyone down. We just danced on each other in roller skates. We're just
surrounded.
Do that.
I'm surrounded by Southerners here. Like, that is not the case in the North, at least not in Illinois.
So you guys are just having giant skating ring parties? No, just us.
What about in Florida? Was that the case for you? Was there skating parties? Was this a thing?
Yeah, so there was like one ice skating rink nearby in, I don't know, Tampa somewhere. It was, I don't know, some place to vacation to. But there were just skate rinks for people with rollerblades on. And you'd go there as a kid, and you'd have parties, and you'd have pizza. And it was called Stardust. And they have a big, like, you know, strobe lights, and it was dark, and there's, like, 90s music playing, and you would just go around and, you know, roller skate in a big rink.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was, you know, and you have to, like, keep your rollerblades on in the bathroom, and you, like, roll into the bathroom. And it was just really weird. To use a stall, use a toilet with rollerblades on.
One time I almost rolled out and my pants were still down.
What?
Yeah, I had to catch on to the
Wow.
That's a little crazy.
No, it was a lot of fun. I miss skating. So Rob really got used to it towards the end. And actually, as he wanted to go solo, I fell. And I was drunk.
She fell
off
trying
this
to show off
love.
To me too, by the way.
And it hurt. Like I fell and I was like, I'm going to throw up. Like,
oh, wow.
My God.
But I fell gracefully, okay?
Speaking of that, I learned a little bit of snowboarding while we were in Montreal, and
lucky
that was
you.
Badass. But I fell a bunch of times. I mean, that's just part of it. But it's just so hard when you try to do something, you know, like when you're trying to learn something for the first time, and there's all these stupid little kids there learning it, and you're like, oh my gosh, you're learning it so young. You're such an advantage.
Yep,
you know,
right.
I'm learning this for the first time, and I'm all developed and stuff, so it's just not, I'm not going to catch on as easily. And you're in my way, and I'm going to be a jerk if I hit you, you know, because you're going down the little slope. There's all these little kids there falling all over the place. They've got people helping them, you know, learn how to do it right. I don't have anyone helping me. I mean, I did have Mateus helping me at some point, but for most of the time, I was on my own, just like trying to basically that was the biggest challenge, is like not hitting one of these little kids.
Yeah, right. You know, there's like bunny slopes where, you know, Allie was going down to practice to begin with, and I was there trying to help her, teaching, you know, trying to give some pointers for snowboarding. And the biggest obstacle wasn't, you know, she got too much speed and wiped out, or the biggest obstacle wasn't that she couldn't master, you know, heel side or something. It was that there were all these little kids and parents and instructors and people like walking up the slope in the middle of the whole thing.
So rude.
And you have to like dodge these people like Frogger. And it's tough enough if you don't really even know how to control what you're on in the first place.
Try not to kill people. And
yeah. And I felt that just going down the slopes myself. You know, I went down some of the easy ones to practice on Friday.
It's supposed to be easier, but it's like a whole different set of challenges.
It's frustrating. Yeah, there's a weird, you know, thing about snowboarding and skiing, that the harder slopes you go on, the more difficult the terrain is. Maybe it's icy or steep or something, but the fewer people that are on there, so there's less of a human risk and more of like an environmental risk.
Did you hit any humans when you're going down?
Yes, there was.
Mateus just looks at Allie like,
yeah. There was this guy. There was this like area where they had a little fence where it's like, every time I went down the bunny slope, this is where I ended up. And this guy was sitting there, and I hit him. And then right after I hit him, another person came down and hit him.
I did see. It was like a three-person pileup.
Oops.
Poor guy.
Yeah, Mar hitting kids.
Wow. When we come back, yep, the FSP hits 98%.
Somebody and then somebody else hit you.
Yeah. It's a two-car pileup on one dude.
Yeah.
You can open the door. It'll get cooler.
Yeah, open
here.
The door.
You might want to take off your jacket. Rebel mistress. You don't want to show the guns to the world. Like that podcast coming. No one has these tickets to the gun show.
You better buy tickets. No, this actually is my rebel mistress. Oh, maybe not.
Topics include sex,
drugs,
white anarchy,
and the police. We are your premier polyamory.
Why do you gotta be hating?
All around fun podcast.
We broadcast every Tuesday night at 10 p.m. Eastern.
Who is sexier in a nerdy way?
I know.
Julie Vrowski.
Want some extra fun? In a nerdy way. Check out. Subscribe to us on iTunes and Stitcher, and join the Rebel Love crew by liking our Facebook page at The Rebel Love Show.
We're just trying to spread the love
of a liberated world.
Yeah,
this is Rob. Yeah. Brokerage Daily Precious Metals update.
There's Nigger and Nigger
trading
too.
Tuesday, gold is up $6 at $1,115 per ounce. Silver is 20
and they
cents
have
higher
taken
at
over the chat.
Cents per ounce. Bitcoin is trading at $391. Gold and silver are making big moves today, fueled by growing concerns in both U.S. and overseas markets. Prepare yourselves.
Yeah, when we come back,
give us a call today at 800-874-9760 or online at rrbi.co.
But it really does feel like
the three most important
like
things you
six
can do
years
for LRN.FM are
I almost don't even remember my old life.
FM on your social networking profile.
I'm serious. Like I barely ever remember it anymore. Like I look back. I just remember it.
Well, it was quite a change.
I've been here 2 years, but it feels like six or more.
It's my firm.
It was quite a change for you.
Is the best use of your
I keep changing too and evolving and being, I don't even recognize myself last year. Have you seen pictures of me from last year to now? I don't recognize myself in the mirror.
Well, you didn't have you didn't have the Samson beard, did you now?
No. I'm actually kind of seeing how far I can grow this beard out at this point. I got this, Ann picked it up for me, but it was by recommendation. I got this really cool beard balm, and it works miracles. Like, it literally does. It gives you so much volume, and it makes it shine. No, it sounds crazy. Beard balm. If you grow your beard out, you use a balm. It's kind of like it's like gel for your hair, but for your beard.
I don't see why they wouldn't make that.
It rocks.
T-Rex Tuesday.
Derek J's Victimless Crime Spree. Free and order the director's cut DVD at victimlesscrimespree.com.
LRN.FM is proud to announce our official listening apps for Android and iOS devices.
Did
now
you see
you
the T-Rex
tune into
chase
our streams
the,
anywhere, anytime on your smartphone or
the
tablet?
The Stay Puft Marshmallow
Just
Man?
Just visit apps.lrn.fm or
No, I've seen a T-Rex app stores.
please download.
He was scooping snow out of the driveway.
Share the link on your social media.
He was like plowing his own driveway with just like a little T-Rex.
Allie, are we wearing the same T-shirt?
Are you a political activist who does things that the government?
Maybe I'm misunderstanding the chat room here.
The chat thinks you're wearing the same T-shirt.
Chat's trying to give us a pro tip.
He's just a fucking troll. Provocateur, narcs, finks,
and similar vermin. Rats was written by OG libertarian Claire Wolf. Rats is a short
beer bomb. Could you be any more hipster? Yes.
Yeah. You don't have any idea how hipster I can be. That's rats-nosnitch.com.
Help get LRN.FM into more ears. Visit promote.lrn.fm for a free bumper sticker, flyers, banners, graphics, and more. Promote.lrn.fm.
Can you close the door? And welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. I'm the Rebel Mistress. I'm here with Rob Mathias, the lovely Allie Havens, and Matthias von Gutenberg, a.k.a. MVP. So big news, the FSP hits 98%, which is probably 99, like right now. Who knows? Every time I breathe, it changes. Last week it was at they needed 608 signers. Now they only need 373. They're predicting that the move will probably be triggered by Monday.
It's gonna be done by the end of this show. At the end of this show, we're gonna celebrate the trigger being moved. And we'll take responsibility for the move being triggered, because it'll happen during our show.
I don't want to be selfish, but my liver can't handle celebrating if it hits now. And I got some work to do tomorrow. So if you could please just wait till Monday. You know, if you really want to wait till like Friday that'll be fine. But I mean, they're predicting Monday. This is what they said, if it's growing a percent every 6 days or so.
It'll be done by the end of the week at this point.
Yeah.
Like we only have a couple days left until the move is triggered. They're literally hitting a percentage point every like, what, 3 days? Four or 5 days?
3 to 5 days. So it makes me wonder, what is going to happen next? Like, the FSP is obviously going to make history. Like, I don't know if you guys have any predictions of what is going to happen, what should happen. Like, what happens when
Matthias?
The move is triggered? Of course, after trying to get all these people.
What does happen are two different things.
Well, I'm asking them what they would like to do. But besides getting these people to actually move, of course, that would take like maybe a few years. But
well, I think once the move is triggered, that's going to, you know, satisfy ancient biblical prophecies, and liberty is going to rain from the sky.
There's a little bit of a spill.
This is why we don't drink while we're doing radio.
So
sorry about that.
Don't worry. I know we drink every episode. Don't worry about it.
So, personally, go ahead. Sorry, Matthias. I didn't think that you could keep going
Didn't think I could keep going.
You can. You got this.
Well, no. I mean, I think it'll be interesting. I think it'll get some publicity. You know, some people that may not have looked into New Hampshire will suddenly hear about it and think about what's all the hubbub. Start looking into it. You know, I think that we'll have a couple thousand movers within a couple years, but I think it's going to be business as usual, pretty much. People just living their lives and doing what is it they're doing anyway, and it's just going to kind of pass, not, I wouldn't say unnoticed, but, you know, it's not going to be some kind of paradigm shift in what we're already doing.
No, I see what you're saying with that. I mean, I really see maybe tops, and this is being optimistic, tops 5,000 people move in the next 5 years. I mean, I think there's 1,000 a year. I think there'd be like one year where it's like a vast majority of them all move within 1 year's time.
That would be like 90 people a month. It'd be triple the rate
I don't
that
know.
We have.
Yeah, but the rate we have is like triple what it was a year ago.
I know, right?
You know?
I mean,
that's not really out of the realm of possibility.
It was like when I was quoted in the Concord Monitor at convention, like people are always saying liberty is dying, but I think it's the complete opposite. Liberty is thriving, especially in the younger community. And I feel like Rob has a lack of optimism. I think this will make history. Just in the simple fact that you got 20,000 people, whether they move or not, to say that, like, I believe in these core values and these core principles, and other people will hear about it just from that. And I think the younger liberty movement is maybe like much
bigger than, you know, everyone we have here, especially like when I go to things like Young Americans for Liberty,
yes,
and like Students for Liberty or whatever. They're really growing into the ideas of liberty. And I feel like, just like me, like when I heard about the Free State Project and what it was and what people were doing here, you know, this is someplace that I wanted to be. I told my friends about it. Like, none of them were like, oh my God, that's weird politics. They were all like, oh my God, like that's inspirational. That's life changing. I've never thought about something that way. So just the simple fact that you said, okay, all these people may not move right away because moving is difficult. You got to pack everything. Like, some people just come what they have. But I think for the younger generation who's looking for something to do, or what's their next step in life, or they're graduating, or they don't want to go to college, they want to find something else. I think what we're doing here and now, when that move is triggered, that's going to really resonate with them. Maybe I should do that. Maybe I should go there. There are 20,000 other people who are like, yes, I want to do that. So I have much like a bigger optimism about what will happen. But I guess my main question is, if it does, once it does hit 20,000 signers and you can't be a Free Stater anymore,
no, you can't
what be. Happens to the organization? Because you're no longer promoting
it's gonna
that.
It's going to find some reason to perpetuate itself. It's gonna
like
find
the government?
Some reason. It's an institution.
I know.
Institutions perpetuate themselves. They take on motivations and intentions and wills of their own. And the people in an institution don't want, you know, what if it's just like dissolves and they just quit and go home?
You're not quitting.
You're evolving.
The whole purpose of the FSP is to get 20,000 signers.
I understand. I'm just saying that people in roles and institutions like that will move the goalposts so often. You know, it's like, well, that was our goal to get 20,000 signers, but now we need to stick around because they need help moving, or they need help socializing, or they need help assimilating or something. And it's like
maybe a couple
inventing
years.
Reasons.
Maybe like a year
continue.
Or two. Maybe like a year or two.
I think it should reform into like a marketing agency. Try to get, you know, try to market libertarians to move up here and everything like that. You know, it's got to change.
Yeah, but we've triggered the move. Now you move here.
Come be a part of this. I just think, you know, I wish it would dissolve. I just think it's like, we're done. Job's done. Let's go home. But I think that certain people in it are going to not want to let go of their institutional involvement with all of this and, you know, all the things and, you know, status they get from that.
Personally, I'm not really putting my optimism and anything to do with like the signers for the Free State Project. I mean, I don't know. I don't know what effects that could have. Mm. I don't know if maybe that will get attention on it. And then someone who's like really cool and is going to come up here and like, we're going to be best friends is going to, you know, like maybe that could set off a chain of events that I'm going to be really happy about that I just can't know at this point. But personally, it's just like so unknown. Who's going to come?
Yeah,
how many people?
Yeah.
Where are they going to be? Like, why did they sign up?
Yeah. That's true.
Are they going to be movers? Are they going to be shakers?
Am I even going to like them?
Yeah.
Well, are they going to be
all 20,000 probably not.
You'll like some of them. But
I guess my point is that like there's already so many people up here who I like who moved before there was any triggering. They didn't need any damn triggering to move up here.
We're all early movers.
They didn't even need
that's what I'm saying is that, yeah, they all decided to move before then. They weren't, you know.
That's why I don't really feel as if, like, you know, obviously not all 20,000 are going to move. My opinion, the only people that are really going to move, anyone that signed in the early years, I'm saying like going back a decade, if they haven't moved now, they're never fucking moving.
Yeah.
Like that's never happening. It's not going to, they're not moving. That's not a realistic thing. In all honesty,
well,
the FSP really went through a change. Like there was the initial people that moved and that was it. And then everyone that signed like the last two or three, maybe 5 years, those people, maybe the last 5,000, they may move, and I'll give them probably more of like a 70% or 60% chance. That's why I say a tops best case scenario 5,000 between now and like the next 5 or 6 years.
And that's why I disagree, because I think the younger people move based off making history and wanting to be a part of something bigger than themselves.
I think it could gain momentum and even surpass 20,000. I don't think it'll happen in 5 years, but I think it'll probably keep accelerating over time. You know, the sixth year isn't going to fall off a cliff. The seventh year isn't going to fall off a cliff.
Yeah.
You know, it'll continue going. It's
well,
just a question
of, I mean,
how large is the scale that you want to look at?
They're thinking about moving the new movers party because it's getting so big. Like every time I go, there's 20, 17, 23 families.
30
like,
people, yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, that's amazing. If you think about, like, yeah, you're only doing this once a month, but compared to when Rob went to his first new movers party and there were two people.
There were two. There was two other new movers at my new movers party.
I remember that.
It was like it's me and like two other guys, two other people. That was it. That was it.
I just mean liberty hasn't died just because we're the only people who moved early. I think some people just need that kind of bigger motivation.
I wouldn't say that liberty's died, but I'm just saying it's hard for me to like get in the shoes of that person who signed the statement of intent a while ago. They haven't really thought about it until they find out, oh, they get here in the news that the move's been triggered and they're like, oh, well, now it's time to start doing it. And it's like, what, when you signed, like, I don't know, for me, when I like decide that I want to do something, that's what my sights are on. Like, I'm not going to be like, I want to do that, so I'm just going to like not think about it until you guys get back to me, and then I'll get and then I'll get all jazzed, and then I'll move my whole life.
I've heard people say like at International Students for Liberty that they wouldn't move until the move was triggered because they want to see more initiative in people.
See, my thing is just seeing the amount of people that already had moved.
People have
like, if I had committed to this, why am I going to spend like building roots and all that jazz and, you know, building more of a community in some other part of the continent or the planet when I know I'm going to move here anyways?
Hey, man.
Right.
Some people got to finish the chapter that they're reading before going on to the next chapter.
That's true.
Maybe it's next page. Maybe it's 10 pages, you know?
No, I think that's fine. But I'm also saying, I guess basically the point is like, to sign the statement of intent basically is like next to nothing as far as the commitment.
It's like saying I'm
You're
going.
Not committing
it's like
to
saying
anything.
I'm going to a Facebook event.
Right.
Yeah. How many people really show?
Like,
is that what Jason Sorens used to estimate the percentage of people that will actually come?
No,
I don't think so.
I think it's like an equation.
I hope not.
Well, we're gonna talk about Liberty Forum when we come back. We're definitely looking forward to that, and we can tell you when you're gonna get to look at us live at Liberty Forum. Yay! I'm kind of drunk, guys. These drinks are strong.
Are you getting squeezed by the economic downturn?
Hey, you were doing fine.
Then all of a sudden you're having a tough time paying your family's credit card bills. Maybe you were downsized or even lost.
Maybe
still owe credit card bills,
and you just can't afford the minimum payments.
Yeah, it's a big deal. It's a big deal. But that's why I think that it'll resonate more with like younger people because they, and it's like they're already moving. That's like the thing.
Yeah, they're already in a period of their life that can be turbulent.
Yeah. And that's what I saw a lot of at International Students for Liberty. It's like, okay, these are like sophomores, juniors. Like, what am I going to do? I'm already into Liberty. Like, what am I going to do after college? And a lot of those people was like, yeah, maybe I'll join the Free State Project. So
that's true.
It's not like, you know, they signed 5,000 years ago and they're like, okay, oh, that's still happening. It's like, you know, I'm young and that's what I want to do after I'm able to. So I don't know. I really see it like making history and being something big because I've seen like how it like affects my peers.
Young hot people need to be moving.
You realize like people who are 22, 23 are still in college. So it's like
they need to go to college.
You're forgetting about that whole.
They need to go to college here.
There's not really that many good colleges here.
Hey, Matias, can you open the door for this is a long break. We've got like 6 minutes. Yeah, we can go outside for a sec.
Come on, you know it.
I gotta use the bathroom.
Yeah.
If you can't listen to the Liberty Radio Network's internet streams, free satellite channel, or radio affiliates, no worries. You can listen to LRN.FM from any phone.
Oh, it's okay. You can get on the computer.
It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling. The Liberty Radio Network listen lines are locked into our stream.
Okay, I'm going to run this outside.
Call 213-493-0309. That's 213-493-0309.
More Rebel Love Show is next, live after the news, here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Tuesday, January 26th, 2016. Silver is trading up $14.25 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,111 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $395. Antiwar.com reports Libya's UN-recognized parliament, the one based in the eastern town of Tobruk, voted overwhelmingly on Monday, 15-89, to reject the call to recognize the new UN-backed
Unity government unveiled last week in Tunisia. The government was an effort by the United Nations to come to some sort of deal to unite the two parliaments, which they insist is the real parliament, and the Tripoli-based one, which is backed by several powerful Western militias. Tobruk members of parliament complained the power-sharing deal gave too much to the Tripoli parliament's faction, and that the 32-member cabinet was far too big, giving the United Nations a week to offer another proposal. The Unity government was already a government in name only, as it was never able to get back into the country and is still stuck in Tunis. The parliament did, however, vote in favor of continuing to back the United Nations effort to mediate a solution with the Tripoli parliament, something the UN cheered as an endorsement in principle. The bill only passed, however, after removing a clause giving a Unity body any power.
For nearly 40 years, Roberts & Roberts Brokerage has been a trusted source for buying and selling precious metals like gold and silver. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and have permanently removed the minimum purchase amount for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Roberts & Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on buying and selling precious metals and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 800-874-9760 or visit online at rrbi.co. UPI reports inmates who were sentenced to life imprisonment as juveniles should be able to file for a reevaluation and possibly attain parole, according to a U.S. Supreme Court ruling on Monday. In a 6-3 ruling, the High Court ruled a 2012 decision prohibiting minors from being sentenced to life in prison without parole should be retroactive to include all applicable cases. In delivering the court, Justice Anthony Kennedy said the ruling does not automatically grant parole, just the right to a review, which could lead to parole. The 2012 decision stemmed from a lawsuit brought by a man who was sentenced to life in prison without the possibility of parole in 1967 as a 17-year-old boy convicted of killing a Louisiana sheriff deputy. Kennedy said the opportunity for release will be afforded to those who demonstrate the truth of the case's central intuition that children who commit even heinous crimes are capable of change. Dissenting Justice Antonin Scalia said the Supreme Court does not have jurisdiction to decide the matter. Justices Clarence Thomas and Samuel Alito joined him in dissent. The Supreme Court's ruling on Monday reverses a decision by the Louisiana Supreme Court and sends the case back to lower courts. The Daily Decrypt is a Monday through Friday newscast about all the best news in cryptocurrencies and peer-to-peer networks. What's hot in the world of digital money, borderless trade, and cutting-edge communication. Available on YouTube, SoundCloud,
good. Facebook, and more.
The
Loosen them up.
This drink is dangerous because you don't realize how drunk you're getting.
Reuters reports two anti-abortion activists behind the filming of videos on fetal tissue procurement by Planned Parenthood were indicted by a Texas grand jury on Monday while clearing the Women's Health Group of any wrongdoing. The videos released last summer led Texas and other Republican-controlled states to try to halt funding for local Planned Parenthood operations, with Republicans in the U.S. Congress also pushing for a funding cut. The grand jury reviewed the case for more than about 2 months, and this decision was a result of a probe launched last year under Texas Governor Greg Abbott, a Republican, who accused Planned Parenthood of the gruesome harvesting of baby body parts. The Harris County District Attorney's Office said in a statement, after a lengthy and thorough investigation by the Harris County District Attorney's Office, the Texas Rangers, and the Houston Police Department, a Harris County grand jury took no action Monday against Planned Parenthood Gulf Coast. Planned Parenthood has denied the accusations and called the probe politically motivated. David DeLeiden and Sandra Merritt were indicted by the grand jury for tampering with a governmental record, according to prosecutors for the county in which Houston is located. The felony charge is punishable by up to 20 years in prison. DeLeiden, leader of the Center for Medical Progress that released the video,
I get to see us in the video at all.
And selling human organs, which is a misdemeanor. This has been FTP Radio News. Online at
what?
FPPradio.com.
We're making it on that?
What, broadcast?
Say it one more time.
I haven't seen us yet in feed. We're making it on that. We can like capture my camera.
Oh, yeah. Refresh the feed on that.
We're watching, but like.
All right, let me put you on the feed right now. Are you watching live?
Yeah, it's not updated.
Just walk outside.
I have you guys on right now.
It just shows the Rebel Love Show background.
Refresh the page and then go to live. And by the way, we go live in like 30 seconds.
We go live at 11:06.
Yeah, it's 11:05.
It's expected
predicted that following the advice in this report will cut down on the largest cause of death among Americans.
Yeah, I know. You got the bottom of the barrel, man.
Hey, when we go live, can you? Because it blocks that camera. That's the only reason why I say close. Otherwise, I say leave it open. But it blocks that camera.
Is that fine?
No. Welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. In studio guests today are Mateus and Allie with the Rebel Mistress here, co-hosting with me here. And the Rebel Love Show, we will be at Liberty Forum. So if Edward Snowden wasn't the reason to buy tickets, now you got a reason.
Now
to
you
buy,
have one.
You have a reason to buy a ticket. Rebel Love Show will be broadcasting live at Liberty Forum on February 20th, Saturday, 2 to 4, literally right before Edward Snowden, because Edward Snowden's scheduled at 4 o'clock. Which
so we can pregame.
We can pregame on the show.
At the Rebel Love Show, get ready for
in the media room at the Radisson Hotel. We're going to be broadcasting from the Radisson. Not even though we're in Manch already, we're not going to broadcast from the studio. We're going to be broadcasting from the Radisson.
Maybe I'll make a drink for both shows.
For both shows? Can you wear your leather on our show too?
Probably not.
Oh, come on.
Anywho,
does Rob ask you to wear your
speaking of
a lot?
Flaming Freedom, yes. where will Flaming Freedom be? Why should all the, if there's not another reason to buy tickets to Liberty Forum?
You can go see Flaming Freedom 3 to 5. The femdom has taken over. It's gonna be myself, Stephanie Murphy, and Leslie Ann Peterson, and we're gonna be dressed in leather. Just saying. So if you didn't have a reason,
will there be whips or anything else?
Handcuffs?
It's a surprise.
Please tell me.
It's a surprise.
I need to know. Ugh.
It's a surprise. So if you want to see that and lick my boot, maybe come down to Liberty Forum. Before the show, I asked Allie how many Liberty Forum she had been to. This is my second one, and I'm so excited. Last year was so much fun. I don't even think I knew you at last year's.
I guess not.
Were you on our show?
I don't think so.
No, you were on Flaming Freedom.
I was on Flaming Freedom.
Talking shit about Polly. That's what you were doing. You and Derek were
talking shit.
Oh yeah, I remember that. You guys were talking shit. Wow. But we have a Skype call.
I didn't think any Polly people would actually hear me. No, I'm just kidding. I don't remember talking shit. But if these guys say so,
then it's probably true. You shouldn't just believe us like that.
I probably said something instead of "it's not for me," which if that's talking shit. Then.
No, you were just like, "I don't get it. I don't understand. Like, why would you want to do that?" And then Derek was like, "Blah blah blah." Anywho, I watched the show. It was a good show.
It was a good show.
So I remember. So I did see you last year, but we weren't friends. We're friends now. Kind of. You let me borrow that lipstick.
Kind of.
Lip stain.
Oh, thank you. I'm learning. Mateus, see, he's getting this shit. So anyway, come to Liberty Forum. Edward Snowden. We got the Rebel Love Show live. I'll be making a special drink for that show. And then we got Flaming Freedom live. Femdom has taken over. And we'll be wearing all leather. And if that wasn't even enough reason to come, the comedy skit show is going to be Thursday night at 9:30.
I'm gonna be in that.
Apparently, yeah. I just found out that I have a cameo appearance in it today.
He's gonna have a special cameo appearance, and he's gonna love it. It's gonna be great. Allie's gonna be in the show, and even Mateus is gonna have a special cameo appearance.
Yeah.
So if that wasn't enough reason to come to Liberty Forum, you want to come to this because this comedy skit is gonna be epic. I tell you, it's really good. I wrote a battle rap in it. That's all I'm gonna say.
Wow. You wrote something? A battle rap?
Yeah, that's I wrote a battle rap.
I thought the battle rap was not happening.
No, it's gonna happen. It's still on.
You got brought back on, motherfucker.
It's
badass from what I've heard, a little bit of it.
You heard the rap?
Well, you told me about, like, you gave me a little bit of a presentation of it.
I did?
Yes. She gave you a little sneak peek at her battle rap. Just a little bit.
So it's basically, can I give you the premises for it?
Yeah.
Give us a verse.
I never get to hear Allie's battle raps.
I'm not gonna give you the verse, but the premise is four activists are at a meetup, a doers meetup, and they start arguing about where's the best place for new movers to move to do activism. And they're arguing, and they can't figure it out, so they decide the only logical solution is to have a battle rap about your prospective locations.
Nice.
So, so it's going to be Manchester versus Portsmouth and Grafton versus Keene.
Wow.
Yeah, so it's going to be.
Is there anyone actually in Grafton?
Exactly.
You don't know. They're not on the internet.
I know. They like turn to Grafton and it's like crickets.
Yeah, it's like crickets.
I know there's
that would be the battle rap. Crickets. But
the only time I ever hear about anything going on in Grafton is when someone goes visits Grafton and then it's like they're telling the story.
It's like, yeah. You know, it's like, oh, Marco Polo's back from China. That's right? Here.
Yeah.
What stories do you have, traveler?
Tell us.
Like,
tell
everything I've ever heard from Grafton. Has literally it's secondhand knowledge. Jack Shimek is like famous for it. So it's
folk tales
about.
And myths.
Tales and like, oh my god, they have the highest concentration of Free Staters.
Yeah, I've heard that. I went to Grafton and
I've never been.
It was an adventure. It was really fun. I mean, it's very natural, and we had breakfast on like a definitely like a makeshift sort of over the fire
aww,
deal.
That's nice.
With like special tools that they had for this and. Like cooked a little egg and made like a little
bacon.
Yeah,
that's and pretty savage. I
yeah,
like it.
No,
that's
what?
Pretty savage.
Oh, it's pretty metal.
It is pretty savage. I like it. Do we have a caller on air? No, we don't.
No, we don't.
He's like, hello, duh. I want to be brought on, and then we bring him on, and then he's like, he hangs up.
Crickets.
Yeah,
well, we didn't say anything after maybe, we answered.
Is he from Grafton?
Probably.
That's what he's calling back to like be like, Allie, don't tell me shit about our over the fire cooking.
I ran out of broadband. They didn't pick up in time.
You know, it's okay. Yeah. We can talk shit about Grafton because they're not on the internet. They probably don't even know that this exists.
Yeah. Oh. They'll never even listen to this show. But anyway,
I love the Grafton.
Their presence will be there at Liberty Forum in this battle ref.
Are they called Graftonites or is it just Graftonians.
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 No. I don't know.
Hello, noble. How can we help you, sir? You got 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 seconds to talk. Okay. I'm going to have to hang up on you now because we got Seth F. calling on the line.
Oh,
you missed it.
I'll bring him up in a second.
So when he brings it up, let me tell you. So also this week, I got a call from CNN.
CNN?
Yeah, from CNN.
Yeah.
And it's because
it's
like
a hot shit.
I circulate my resume a lot back when I was looking for work, and I still leave it on like certain sites. And I've been a part of like focus groups, and they want me to answer questions because like it's all about demographic and
young black female.
Exactly, young black female with a degree. So like they often ask me to
it's trifecta. A dangerous thing.
Yeah, trifecta over here. So they always ask me to be on this kind of thing. So CNN called. And, you know, I don't even politics, even though I want to run for state rep. But they called and they were like, hey, like, we checked out your demographics and your background. And we'd really like it if you could come and be a live studio audience in Manchester as they reveal the results from the Iowa caucus.
Oh, my God. Hey, you look like you're a woman in black. Do you want to come and, you know, give your opinion on political results?
Yeah, yeah. Kind of. But except I'm just going to be sitting there like when they read them and they want to see my reactions to the candidates and the election and whoever wins.
Everything. You have to just facepalm. Just be like, oh.
Yeah. I want to have like a Donald Trump bag. And then if he wins, throw up in it. And then a Bernie Sanders bag. And if he wins, throw up in it. Like, and just like kind of keep it going.
Yeah.
Just get drunk the whole time. And at the very end, just induce vomiting into the respective bag.
Yeah. That'll be a good reason to get drunk.
That's hilarious.
Just remember, act status all the way up till you're on camera. All right.
When I'm on camera,
Very statist.
Well, actually,
act as if like, hoorah, there's an election. I should be happy that there's people voting.
Go blue team.
Yeah.
Go blue team.
Go red. Fuck the blues. Go red.
Okay. Well, they actually said if I have more friends that fit my profile, that I should invite them as well.
You should invite
your profile.
Babe, like me. I fit your profile.
I feel like you fit my profile.
Look, I'm a college grad too.
Yeah.
Not only that.
Like, they didn't specify what they mean.
Mateus
like libertarian.
Is Brazil,
Brazilian.
Yeah. I'm Persian. She's a woman.
Alabamian.
Alabamian.
Yeah. Alabamian.
We both have Southerner. Long hair. We're both from Alabama.
You totally fit my profile. Same we both like the same lipstick stain.
Same lip stain. CNN. Same lip stain.
I thought by similar profile you meant women that like the lip stain I like.
No, that's not what you meant. Well, you should have clarified. But anyway, it was actually a really funny conversation. And she like they screen you, of course, but like the questions they asked were like, "Oh, are you voting this year?" I'm undecided. Well, who would you vote for? I'm undecided. What party are you?
I played the fifth.
I'm undecided.
That's perfect.
Am I being detained?
Well, we're going to talk a little bit more about some politics when we come back.
Are you tired of governments murdering people around the world?
Stop using their money.
There is an alternative. Bitcoin is a stateless free market non-political currency. Bitcoin cannot be inflated or controlled by any government.
Can you open the door again? This is strong. The last bits of this were strong.
I know that too.
Hey, Seth, you there? Learn it.
Yeah, I'm here.
Hi, Seth. We're going to come back on in air in a little bit if you mind waiting.
Yeah, do you hear any feedback?
Okay, no problem. No, I just have this $5 headphone thing that I got from Big Lots, and I didn't know if it was going to work, but apparently it did, so we're in.
Okay. Yeah, we're on commercial break right now. We're back in a few minutes.
Okay. Do you guys have a sort of topic or theme that you've been talking about tonight? I just tuned in.
We've kind of been all over the place, but that's kind of what we normally do.
Okay.
But you can bring up whatever you want. You can act like this is Free Talk Live and just ask, bring up any subject. That's fine with me.
Well, I don't. What do you guys feel like talking about? I mean,
politics right now. I'm gonna read this status when I come back, and then you can feel free to comment on it.
You can talk about how Trump is crazy.
Stream running live. Yeah, I was here both. So go ahead.
Oh, I said I'm gonna read the status when we come back that I found interesting about politics and ad campaigns. And then you can just feel free to comment on it. I'm bringing it back.
Right? Riff on it?
Yeah, okay, yeah, bring it back.
Hugh White Pride World.
It's a department store at your fingertips. Shop.lrn.fm. Get all your shopping done. Get a great deal. And a portion of your purchase goes to benefit the Liberty Radio.
Yellow Fever.
You
really?
Shop at Amazon via shop.lrn.fm.
Is that Neil?
On Free Talk Live.
Is that what? Is that Neil? From
wrestling superstars like Glenn Jacobs.
It might be.
I'm sad about Neil.
I know.
You don't want to say that on air.
Well, he's already posted that he's gone on the internet. What? So he's already posted selfies of himself in Europe.
That's true.
So it's not like it's the cat's out of the box. He's left the
cat's out of the
Shire.
Box. That's the expression.
Is that?
I can't even drink my drink.
Yeah, just you keep hitting the microphone when you're drinking, babe. That probably
well, when I get drunk, my hand like coordination isn't very well.
Directly change more lives by getting Free Talk Live in front of people looking for talk radio online and on the air. When you amp Free Talk Live, you get perks like access to the AMP only Facebook group and AMP podcast. Visit amp.freetalklive.com.
Did you know you can listen to LRN.fm via our free-to-air satellite channels? We have channels over nearly all of North America and much of Africa. All you need is an affordable receiver and a dish as small as 30 inches. There are no monthly fees. Learn more at sat.lrn.fm. Plus, if you are a broadcaster or want to be one, there's a good delivery method for our content. See our coverage maps and get details at sat.lrn.fm. That's sat.lrn.fm. sat.lrn.fm.
In Survivor Max 2, School Bites, Maximus scavenges through a wasteland swarming with the undead. Desperate to find the medicine he needs, he discovers a community of survivors at his former school. Has he finally found
my
the safe haven he's been looking for, or will he?
Which one?
Gina, she just sent me a video for parking. Max on Facebook. I don't get this.
Really?
Yes, really. At
SurvivorMax.com. That is weird.
This is the Liberty Radio Network, broadcasting the latest liberty-oriented audio content 24 hours a day.
Oh,
I was dumb smash. And And welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. I am the Rebel Mistress, and I'm here with Rob Mathias and Allie Havens and Matthias von Gutenberg. And we have a special Skype caller called Seth. Want to say hi, Seth?
Hello, there, Seth. Hello.
Maybe his name isn't Seth.
I'm here. Sorry.
Oh, hi, Seth. He said hi. Hi,
so,
Seth.
So what's your question or story you had to tell?
Did he have
a question?
Yeah, you're a caller, dude. What's up?
Oh, I thought you guys were going
to... Yeah, I have something to read.
Oh,
that's going to comment.
That's right.
Go for it. So I had someone write on Facebook, and I thought it was very interesting. She said, just listen to the Hillary ad. If you think the problems in the economy are due to CEOs' pay, you are falling for tricks. Politicians love to point the finger away from the institutions they work for and at wealthy people. Not because they don't like wealth. They just know you'll go along with the lie because you think the economy is a piece of pie. And if the CEO gets a big piece, well, that leaves less for the rest of us. It's so sad how this works. The state is like an addiction that promises to make it all better. But you should really know better by now. My question is,
who's that pretentious bitch?
That pretentious bitch is Allie Havens, who I Facebook stalk.
Ah, that's me.
But I found this really interesting because I did want to talk about terraforming and democide a little bit later. But what really stuck out to me is people should really know better by now. But when I look at things, even like CNN calling me and say, hey, I want you to be a live studio. I'm like, you know, what are the reasons for that? Like, you know, they could have had a lot of great reasons, but I can really just look at the main reasons is demographics. They want demographics and they want people who
no.
they might think. Won't come up and just do crazy shit like out of the way, like yeah, like politics. But I don't even politics. They got the wrong fucking person here. They don't know what they're getting into.
I think they loved you on Seditious Sirens, and they just want to get your opinion.
Yeah, they must be huge fans of Seditious Sirens.
That's why they want you. Probably what it is. But back to people should really know by now. I think when it comes to politics, that's what a lot of people are thinking, that people know better or they should know better. So, you know, who's going to vote for Trump? Who's going to vote for these people? But as I like look more and more at, you know, just people's comments on Facebook, the people I interact with when I'm doing activism, is they don't know better. And they don't know better. Maybe it's because of the indoctrination, or maybe it's because like that's the only thing they've ever known. Do they think like these are actual viable like candidates and people to rule over you? But even the fact that people still think that you need someone to rule over you, you need to be ruled, you need to be told what to do, is kind of what makes me think people don't know better, and they never will know better, because we still have this system and people still believe in it.
It frustrates me, I guess, that the tricks are like the oldest ones in the book. I mean, just turning people against each other and stuff. It's like, you know, if I just like wanted to make a group of people like hate each other and stuff, I would just start pointing out where one group has more than the other, and like how that's, well, clearly the group that has more is at the expense of the ones that don't have as much. So you guys that don't have as much, you should really, I mean, and then you guys who have more, you should look out for the ones that don't have as much, because they're going to try to steal from you. And then immediately you just have war, which proliferates into like, now we're going to war with other nations and stuff, because we think that their trading policies somehow affect, like, oh, China is selling more products than we are, so that hurts us. No, they're selling the goddamn products to us at a like cheaper rate than we would buy them otherwise. It benefits us. It's a mutual exchange. It, like, we're all better off because China is selling so many products. It's like ridiculous that people always see this as like black and white. One group is winning, so that must mean that we're losing.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're well, first off, they always like to say we and us. I try not to say it, but like when they're talking about that's them. Like I'm all in favor of every human being human being, and I'm all in favor of everyone trading and, you know, being prosperous. I want China to be prosperous, just as like everyone in China just doesn't want everyone in the United States to be prosperous. And everyone
exactly, we're
the
just
world.
Talking about individuals in China. We're not talking about China. I mean, they just say that.
But we look at things collectivist that way.
That's another trick of state agents, though. It's another kind of, you know, kind of illusion. It's to help you forget that we're talking about other human beings that are on their kind of unique tax farm, kind of their own human farm.
Yeah.
And we just think of it as China or as Vietnam or as we got to take, you know, Iraq or whatever. And we forget that, oh, we're actually talking about like 12 and a half million people that are kind of like starving and poor.
Exactly.
And don't have anything fucking to do with what these like military leaders in our country are pushing for.
It's the same thing with war. People look at it the exact same way.
Yeah.
And they really shouldn't, because when you look at war, you should look at it as it is. This is war. People are dying. Like, it's not like, oh, Iraq, Afghanistan. No, like babies.
And then
children,
China,
school
did
teachers,
this.
People's getting on buses. Like, they're getting blown up.
Getting limbs blown apart.
Yeah. Right. Just trying to go to the grocery store. And it's because we're looking at things that way. It's because the state wants us to look at things that way.
Right.
If we really looked at war, like I say in my blog, we'd see how violent it is. Like, it should never be okay for us to sit around and casually talk about how drones are killing babies across the sea. Like, it's
right. Well, I mean, like, we're at a point now where literally millions of people have been killed in the last, 20 years by United States government. I don't know. I've lost count of how many people that are responsible, that the U.S. government's responsible for in some way or another of killing people, not to mention spying and everything we do. Like, I literally don't know what more it takes. I mean, we see the government for what it is, the illegitimacy of it, the fact that they kill and steal and spy and enslave not just us, but the entire populace of the planet. At what point does the federal government have no legitimacy? Like, you know, like to the status person.
It's not a black and white thing. You know, I'm going to kind of, you know, draw back a little bit to Morpheus, you know, when he says that not everyone is ready to be unplugged. Certain people get there at different speeds, you know, and to them, the state dies, or it's dying, you know, in their minds or whatever. And eventually there'll be enough people who just refuse to passively resign to state rule, or who actively oppose it, or, you know, who maybe sabotage it in some way or whatever, where the actual functions of the institution can't carry on anymore. But, you know, it's each person kind of arrives there independently, you know, on their own, however far they're willing to go down the rabbit hole, right, to kind of continue the metaphor.
Yeah.
No, I'm definitely
Seth,
hearing on that.
Do you have any thing you'd like to add?
Yeah. I mean, that last comment, I think, was pretty insightful. It's really frustrating because, you know, there's a part of me that worries and frets, especially about the future of my children. And, you know, is the ship going to be turned around before we're wiped out, or there's another a democide that occurs in the United States? I mean, you see this maelstrom of violence that seems to be spiraling out of control in different parts of the world. And part of me fears that it's just like a matter of time before that starts to reach us here. So. With the words to the, you know, the political horse race, I mean, I don't understand the obsession with following the presidential candidates within libertarian anarchist circles, you know, for lack of a better label, but I hate it. I can't stand it, but it seems like there's no escape, you know, it just keeps forcing its way into my life consciousness. That, like, everywhere you go, it makes me
I think
crazy.
It's more so because
I totally feel you on that.
A lot when you get down to libertarian anarchist rabbit holes and you get all the way down there, you see the system for what it is, and
it's
unfortunately
everywhere.
It's everywhere.
Yeah,
and
everywhere.
Politics are, you know, the government is what rules us, and who's going to be the next ruler kind of, you know,
it's irrelevant.
It's all everyone talks about.
Yeah.
Well, more politics when we come back.
Every once in a while, you get in.
Can you play Sarah Palin's SNL?
The last time I played an SNL skit, I got flagged. But I can play during break, I guess. Hey, Seth, thanks for calling, dude. You got anything else really quick for the break? Seth?
But now you
Hello?
Can get a 25% discount on nearly everything you need.
Is he calling right now?
I've just given you a huge raise,
offline.
And all you have to do is claim it.
Anyways.
You go to saveitpurse.com and open
so,
it.
So, on this SNL skit. Right now,
don't wait. Then you
so, I watched this SNL skit. And it is Tina Fey playing Sarah Palin at the endorsing Donald Trump, her speech to endorse him, whatever. But I hadn't seen the actual speech. So I'm watching Sarah Palin just say all these, like, fucking ridiculous, I mean, what's her name?
Yeah, Tina Fey.
Tina Fey say all these, like, fucking ridiculous things, and I'm like,
I can see
was it really
Russia from my door?
Was it really like this? Like, is she, like, going overboard, or was this really what was going on? And then I go look at her speech, and it's like the exact same things, and I'm just like, is this for real? Like, people are watching this shit and, like, just, like, applauding it and going crazy for it. Like, this bitch sounds like she's on cocaine. you didn't get the approval, probably crack. Like, just the thing she is saying is like so ridiculous. I'm like, how can people like justify this? These are the rulers you want.
Yeah.
This is who you think is like should rule you. Not that you should think anyone should, but this girl's up here rhyming. She's like, oh, the click clacks and the big backs and Donald Trump creates fire. Like, she literally said that. She said Donald Trump creates fire.
Like, she literally said, it's hilarious. In the skit, she says that, and then we watch the actual speech.
And she's like saying these things.
Sure enough, she actually says Donald Trump creates fire.
She's saying these things, and they're for real.
Allie and I had to dig the other night to find the clip at the Donald Trump rally where the Muslim man gets kicked out, and he tells people to keep his coat. He's like, don't give him his coat back. Keep his coat. We'll send it to him in a couple of weeks. Make him go out in minus 10 degree weather. Whatever. It's like it's outrageous.
He threw a Muslim lady out for silently protesting.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah.
And thunderous applause.
You know what pisses
thunderous
me off?
Applause.
It pisses me off when I see pork supporting Donald Trump. What the fuck is that about?
Yeah, we got to talk about this when we come back here, because we're going to talk about taking LSD.
Yeah, I want to talk about that.
I don't know that they pork support Bernie Sanders, but the libertarians I see that support Bernie Sanders.
Yeah, I've seen
that. And they're not like accelerationists. They're not, you know.
Yeah, they
are, okay, do you
yeah,
think,
get their shit over with.
Do you think there is a... what's what I'm looking for? It gives us more exposure. Do you think people that want to accelerate the collapse of the federal government are in the right or wrong? Do you think those are correct activists?
You know what? What you think about my morals doesn't matter.
Well, I mean, some people support Trump and Sanders and others because they view those people as a way to bring down the federal government faster.
They're anarcho.
Whatever they think, that's fine. If they want to say that.
I mean,
if we get to the end goal faster than the normal progress, isn't that a step in the right direction?
Yeah.
So if someone had to win, who would win? And then that's answering the question, like, who would you vote for? Which I was going to ask you guys on the air.
There was an interesting, idea there when you think about, like, well, if you pick better presidents, like Rand Paul or Gary Johnson or whatever, that they might do better things, you know, not be in charge of a runaway train anymore, you know, but, like, reform the government and slash the budget and do all these things, whatever. I can't help but think that while that would be beneficial in the short term, it would just kind of continue to perpetuate the idea that, like, everything's okay. We don't need to shake anything up. This
it
is
doesn't
a fine thing.
Solve the ratcheting effect.
The doomsday clock
no, it
is...
No, it doesn't. It pauses it maybe or yeah. whatever, but...
The doomsday clock is 3 minutes to midnight.
The idea that with, like, Donald Trump or Bernie Sanders in there is that they're going to, like, actively do shit that's going to bankrupt the government or incite civil unrest or whatever, and that's going to be like, all right, now we're getting somewhere. Now we're actually going to have, like, a chance at rolling the die and
welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. We are discussing politics. We had a lovely guest on air. I'm here with Rob Mathias, Ali Havitz, and Matthias von Gutenberg. And we're talking about politics a little bit because
well, my question is, and Matthias kind of brought this up during the break, and if you want to hear what we're doing during the break, go to rebellovshow.com/live. You can actually listen.
Or you can Skype us
Skype
and we can chat
Rebel
live.
Show if you want to call in. So there's this, basically, there are anarchists out there that believe that, supporting a presidential candidate will, you know, especially someone as extreme as Trump or even, say, Sanders, will speed up the collapse of the federal government. And that's what we want to start with. Do you guys feel as if, like, that is, like, the correct thing? Is that something that, you know, as other anarchists and volunteers,
if I can
support?
Answer first, I was kind of a nihilist, I guess, an anarchist.
Please don't say you're a nihilist. You got to believe in something. You gotta believe in love and happiness and living. Like,
okay,
if you're
so
nihilist,
I'm not
just
a
go,
nihilist.
Please don't say you're a nihilist.
I think I am pro-apocalypse, so maybe that does make me a nihilist.
Why are you pro-apocalypse?
Because
what the fuck are you talking about?
I feel like I feel like the whole reason, like, that I want to talk about politics because I read the whole doomsday thing, and as I've said many times, like, I believe the apocalypse is likely and it could happen. So the doomsday clock is set, I think, about like 3 minutes to midnight, and they just decided to keep it at the same place. And this is because of climate change. It's because of how many nukes are like set to launch. It's how fast the world could end if it were going to end.
But what is the doomsday clock, by the way?
I thought I just
explain. You just said there's a doomsday clock. Doomsday clock is basically, I forget the backstory. If it was created in, during the Cold War, it's basically how close we are to Armageddon on this planet. It's gone it's gone up and down.
But not lately. They kept it at the same thing, which is, I mean, I said that, but basically how close the world is to ending because of climate change, nuclear weapons, basically the stupidity and extreme violence of government, because that is what will ultimately cause the world to end. And, you know, some people are like, oh, well, so, you know, 3 minutes, this is unrealistic. But if you look at like all the science that they put into this, which I'm not a scientist by any means, but like I read this kind of thing, especially as someone who believes like the world could end because people are extremely violent. And when you have presidents who are like saying like hateful things, and then you hear this thunderous applause, anti-Muslims, kick this like fat lady out of here, and just saying like all these hateful things. And I see people cheering for that. I see people like rooting for that. That makes me think that the world is at a standstill. Like, this is horrible. And the government just keeps getting horribler and horribler. It was exposed. They're spying on everyone in the entire world. And guess what happened? Nothing. Nope. So it's just getting worse.
What's even worse than that are the anarchists that actually support that.
Yeah. But
what's wrong with that?
I just mean like the reason I feel like they could get us there closer is because we're already close. And I think people don't realize the severity of that. Like, how many people think that extreme violence is going to solve their cause? It's not the masses. It's the select few people who want to build giant walls and like nuke brown people across the sea. And like, it's those people who make me think that the apocalypse is near. Like, not that I think it wouldn't happen at all, but it's definitely going to happen because of government, is what I think.
I think that there's a certain kind of strategy in mind here when people want to, you know, when otherwise libertarian anarchists want to support Sanders or Trump or support Hillary or just like support the worst, whatever the worst in their mind happens to be.
But that's tongue in cheek. That's not the same as actually supporting.
No, there's
people.
It's supporting them in the sense that like they want them to gain the power so they can fuck it up faster and accelerate to some kind of political or social Armageddon. And they think that through the, you know, sulfur raining from the sky and through all of the buildings on fire, then that would be the opportune time, like some kind of like Trotsky revolution, that we can really reclaim some, you know, some kind of revolutionary, you know, attitude and build this anarchist society. And I think that that's one of the reasons they support it. I think that's a bad strategy. I think it's very unlikely that in the middle of massive civil unrest and Arab Spring type shit that you're going to have, you know, the infrastructure or the environment or the social setting to develop the kind of peaceful anarchist society you want.
No, I don't think,
you know,
that
I think people
will...
should basically keep calm and crypto on
and
forget all this silly horse race.
Let me clarify. I don't think that they'll rebuild. I think that's why I feel like it's a nihilist point of view. Like, I feel like it'll end and it'll stay ended for a while until civilization like rises up into something else.
To be perfectly
honest. And that'll take about like 5, 10, 20 years. So basically, I feel like our generation, nothing we can do.
It could take hundreds of years. The Dark Ages were for hundreds of years after Rome fell.
Yeah.
I honestly think our best bet is literally just to walk the walk and try and live the free life that we want to live. Because as much as we want the federal government or even the government period to not be in our lives, there's always going to be enough people that vote, that take part in the system, that have like this deep seated religious view.
So
of
what
the,
you're saying is
government.
It's inevitable. So like that's what
it's not
I'm
inevitable.
Hearing. You say like if people are still going to want this government and cling to this system because it's the only thing they've ever known, the system is going to collapse within itself.
I just want to say that I don't think that people are inherently violent. I think that they need the right context in which they can feel okay being violent.
It's the government with the nukes.
And then
us.
I also, right. So I don't think that's people who are necessarily violent. I think people in their, like 99% of the time, 99% of people or something ridiculous like that are peaceful in their interactions with others.
Yeah.
And that like, you know, and we're not just talking about peaceful, benign, regular interaction. We're talking about like things that are making breakthroughs. We can't ignore the threshold that we've passed in technology where now we're like so connected and there's been so many things that have happened where there's just no going back. I mean, we can't ignore the positive when we start talking about like, oh, it's all downhill from here. Yeah, it's great that the politics stuff is downhill from here because there's not much saving that. And I don't want to save it.
I mean, I feel like you're not thinking about things in the bigger picture. Because as you say this, like about technology, I'm thinking like we're thinking about us and technology. Yes, technology is vast. I definitely believe in the singularity, but I don't feel like that can happen while we have a government because they own that technology.
True. And anything
anything that's going to make, that's going to give you more power than them, they're already restricting it. They're already reading your Facebook messages. They're already reading your tweet. It's true. Edward Snowden proved it. They're already reading your Twitter messages.
Well, I'm just saying, I don't think it's true.
They have more technology. Technology that we don't even know about is out, that they have in their hands. That's something that we all know. They're experimenting with measles. Like, we all know that they're doing stuff that we don't know about. If you think your government is 100% honest with you of what they have and what they can do with the technology they have, they'll have that technology before you. And the thing is, they want to control you.
So, yeah, like,
those who have power will not give it up easily. They never have and they never will. We will go to a nuclear war before the system says, okay, we'll just call it quits.
If they start nuking people, they'll start a world war.
Exactly.
That's not what they, unless you really believe in the whole Illuminati stuff that they want to like cull most of the population, which
a world war. I just think that our government has this technology, and I think technology is inevitably the answer to how we get rid of the system, but they have it first. So how are we going to get rid of that middle level?
The government definitely has an advantage on technology, but the window between where the average person has a technological footprint and the government is ever, it's ever getting smaller and smaller.
It's getting smaller, but it's not small enough.
Well, technology is not some static thing that you either have or don't, or I have more of it than you do.
Or I am in control of it and you're not.
Right. Technology is varied and technology is in a million different angles. So something like Bitcoin is technology. But
that they're constantly trying to shut down through
it doesn't matter though, because the technology, the state can't use Bitcoin technology in a way to hurt us. It's technology that's put in a certain direction that is liberating rather than controlling.
But even now, like at that point, they're still trying to regulate it. They're still trying to like make it so it's harder.
Of course they are.
It doesn't matter though. The technology is of such a way that all of that is impotent.
Exactly. We just rise above it.
Not when they start arresting peaceful people.
It's still impotent. Well, they do that. You can't arrest everyone. Anyways. You can't.
Exactly.
Yeah, but it shouldn't be one. As long as there's one and the government still exists, I don't see us moving on. But we'll talk more when we come back.
I'm Ian Freeman, host of Free Talk Live.
Oh, this is the last segment?
Yeah, it's the last segment. The Seth keeps wanting to call. He keeps calling, trying to call in.
Your right to give people rides without asking government permission. I wanted to support Uber more directly, so I signed up to be a driver. It's fun.
You there, Seth? And
help. Yeah, dude, I'm so sorry. That was the weirdest thing I've ever happened to me. Like, I can only contact you via Skype if I'm signed into my VPN service. I tried it without it. It wouldn't dial or ring or anything.
That's bizarre.
We're on the break, but go ahead and talk.
Oh, I just missed that you're just starting to talk, and then my Wi-Fi connection dropped, and I've been spending this entire time just trying to get reconnected. But
says I
so maybe you want to give me just a short summary of what you're going to say after I talk, and then I can go from there.
Say it one more time. I'm sorry. Say it one more time. What do you want to talk about?
Oh, maybe you can give me like a 15-second summary of the comments you made before I dropped off and pick up from there.
Anne was rocking it out, apparently, according to the prophet, peace be upon him.
What were we talking about before?
I don't know. I kind of want to talk about this article about an LSD experience at the Trump rally.
Nice.
Oh, man. Do you want to experience, like, existential fear?
Yeah, basically, that is exactly what happened. They started tripping balls, and just the amount of hate going on around them. Like, they tried to flee and they couldn't do it, and their best bet was just to bunker down and go through it.
Man, sounds like torture.
Yeah, it's a bad idea. Don't ever trip at a Trump rally.
Have you guys even gone to a political rally like that before? I haven't.
The only kind of political rally I've ever gone to, I went to I participated in a Ron Paul float in 2012.
Ron Paul.
Me too. That's the only political rally I've been to is a Ron Paul thing.
What was the experience like?
It was fun. We were going down Lakeshore Drive in Chicago with like 500 of us at a Ron Paul float, handing out Ron Paul with the vote in the primary. I don't know. It was kind of fun being around that many libertarians. No, in Chicago, you're normally not around that many people that are liberty-minded. Here, it's just like a normal thing. But there, it was not a normal thing. So it was a cool experience just to be around so many like-minded people.
That's another thing about, you know, when is the state going to end? New people are being born all the time, and they're being born to statist families, and they're being put into these indoctrination facilities.
See, I was going the opposite way, that new people are being born all the time who haven't been, like, had their brains cooked by
more liberty babies.
But they're about to be. They're on the conveyor belt to have their brains cooked.
I think that I just think that it gets better all the time. It's getting better all the time.
It does. It does. It does get better all the time. I agree.
I think it's getting worse.
But the reason why it hasn't ended yet is that the state still has a very like large advantage in sheep growing capability. You know, like, you know what I mean? Like, the people that are being born are predominantly statist, and maybe they're becoming more liberty-minded over time.
Like, as long as you're going to public schools and they're teaching you their history and what you should and shouldn't be doing, they're making you stand for the pledge, they're making you dress a certain way.
Take your Ritalin.
Our parents took that shit so much more seriously than we ever did, and then like this next generation is going to care even less. The third graders have cell phones, y'all.
Yeah,
they can just immediately be like,
third graders, kindergartners.
That sounds like bullshit, teacher. I'm going to look it up. And then it's like, you are feeding us bullshit. Okay.
But they're also starting to drug people at a younger age. And that's been proven too. They're letting 11-year-olds take Oxy now, which is like basically heroin. So it's like, yes, technology is getting us to a point where we can like surpass this, but like I don't feel like the government is gonna let that happen.
Yeah, there is also kind of a brave new
world type of fear. I don't
think
they can do anything about it. They think that they can stop it. I just think that I think it's like
as long as they have a monopoly on violence, like the amount of
people do. I don't think that's the be all end all.
It's not the be all end all because.
Welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. This is the bottom of the hour, and hour two. I'm here with Mateus, Ellie, and the Rebel Mistress. And we're talking about the insanity that is known as the system that we live in called politics and everything else. And I kind of want to go over an article I saw earlier this week. And I don't know if everyone here at this table kind of seems like they are somewhat a psychonaut in somewhat or another. And apparently a group of people decided to be a fun experience, which they later regret, taking LSD at a Donald Trump rally.
What a waste of LSD.
Right? Like, right? You save LSD.
The one
for like,
I'd want to take it.
You save that for the moment of like, you know, I don't know. Like you save that for, you save that for like a festival, a music festival, a party, you know, not a Donald Trump rally.
Did you ever watch, what was it, Batman Begins, and the villain, the Scarecrow, had all the pharmaceuticals, and he would, like, spray people, and it would, like, instantly give them hallucinations and terrify them? That's kind of what I imagine LSD at a Donald Trump rally is like. You're just, like, inviting his existential fear immediately for, what, an hour, 2 hours into your life, and you're surrounded by people who feed on that fear and who perpetuate that fear.
I already don't
analyze.
I don't really like being around people who aren't tripping when I'm tripping, unless like they're there to babysit me or something like that.
Ellie gets really huggy when she's.
If they're also like racist and warmongers and sexists and they're all rude.
Why would you even want to surround yourself with people like that?
Was he trying to evaluate everything Trump was saying?
If you're going to write an existential novel afterwards, maybe, but.
Yeah,
I can't evaluate what Trump is saying when I'm sober.
No, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, I looked at him when I was sober, and on the break, you know, we discussed Sarah Palin, whole Saturday Night Live. We watched that first, and then we watched her actual, endorsing Donald Trump, and it was just, like, the most ridiculous fucking things I had ever heard. And I'm watching Saturday Night Live, and you know how they exaggerate, so I'm like, yeah, this is funny. Like, let me see what happened in the real thing.
It was exactly the same.
It was no fucking difference, and I was like, is this for real? Like, someone can literally get up here and be like, I'm click clacking on these, like, motherfuckers, and vote for Trump, don't pussyfoot, motherfucker. Well, like, what is she even saying? Then she starts shaking, well, and I don't know.
It's worse than that. Like, sometimes, like, I'm a radio junkie. Like, I'll listen to talk radio. I'll listen to AM radio, like, especially, like, local Manchester radio on my way to work. Just, you know, it's only for, like, 15 minutes. I'll listen to it, and I'll hear a political commercial. I'll hear a Trump commercial or a Cruz commercial or something like
Hillary
that.
Hillary commercial.
And it's literally everything. I can't believe it's an actual
ad
where it's saying, we'll go kill ISIS and we'll make America great again. We'll build that wall. And I'm like, holy.
It's hilarious. It might as well be satire.
Exactly.
But it's not.
It's like Erica's satire, but it's actually legit.
But it's real.
Commercials.
We'll find Boogeyman and we'll deport him.
Yeah. Exactly. That's might as well what they should be saying. But it's just the amount of people who are buying into this. Because though we're thinking of it like rationally and normally, there are a lot of people. And I feel like people need to know that. That's why I hate when Rob blocks like all these hateful comments and stuff. Like, don't block
them.
People,
I don't block comments. I've deleted a couple comments.
Like,
after a while, I kind of just let them go.
Yeah, because I'm just like, let them say this thing. Because people need to realize this is what people are actually thinking.
Yeah, it's
this
good to have it out in the open.
And there are people who want this kind of stuff to happen. It's not just us saying, you know, oh, we think this is crazy. I really want to hear why someone thinks this is logical.
Isn't that what, don't they have the word for these people, like the silent majority? Is that what they're called? Like, you know, there's a term for these people out there who it's like they're not PC.
He's just saying what we're everybody thinking.
And yeah, it is. It's like no, Trump is saying what apparently a lot of people are thinking and not saying, and it's like
He's probably going to win the Republican nomination.
It's just as bad.
That's how crazy it is.
It's just as bad with Bernie, though. Like,
I know.
The hate from the Bernie side is directed to different things than the hate from the Trump side.
Yeah.
But with, you know, with the whole Bernie side, it's like, free milk and cookies from those greedy bakers.
He Bernie's just as bad as Trump. They both want just control and steal everything.
Yeah, it's like the like control. Two jets dropping bombs. You got Donald Trump's one over here, and then you got Bernie Sanders with like the free love and peace written across it, but they're still dropping fucking bombs. Like it doesn't matter.
Have a nice day.
you got Obama right now, the Nobel Peace Prize, dropping Nobel Peace Prize missiles from drones, killing other Nobel Peace Prize winners in fucking Afghanistan. Like, that's the case right now, and no one bats a fucking eye.
What's hilarious to me is you guys were talking before about, like, is it the right position for anarchists to be like, I want to vote for this person because they're going to bring down the state?
It's
you know,
not a
easiest.
Correct position but, for an anarchist to even vote.
Well, I mean, we could debate that another show. We don't have time here. But my thing is that, like, it's ridiculous to me that you'll hear libertarians and anarchists pretending like Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders or Hillary Clinton's policies would be that different if they were elected.
Yeah, right.
They're like, well, what flavor do you want? It's like, it's the same flavor. It's poop flavor.
Yeah, just dye it yellow or you dye it red or you dye it green. The dye can taste a little bit, but it's just poop.
It's still poop, no matter how you look at
it.
But I think this like particular election is very, like, it's big.
There's
because every candidate you have here is, like, for just some way, just ironic. Like, no matter who you look at, it's just like, this person, this is your race now, America. Yeah. You want these people to lead you. Good luck. Congratulations.
This election is,
you deserve it.
This is for the anarchists that want to bring down the government as fast as possible. They actually have choices running. They have candidates that could literally win and bring down the federal government and create more wars and bring down the entire system and the entire world. Like, they actually have those candidates running. Those anarchists, which I'm not supportive of, you know, mostly brutalists and whatnot, their candidates are there.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
On both sides. Like, they almost have a win-win situation.
I just can't get behind, like, people supporting extreme violence. And I really wish that people would look at it for what it was. Because I look at war as something just inhumane, unnatural, and something that just should not happen. It's like
slave on slave
people
violence.
Like bad or not, they don't even care. They
don't even care.
They just want
and
the violence.
That is such a good point that to sit there and say, I mean, even if I see it as tongue-in-cheek, to be like, I'm going to vote for this person because they'll bring down the state sooner because their policies will be so bad. I mean, it's like, if you think about how people will die in the process, it's really fucked up and insensitive. And it's like, are you really that anti-war if you really are taking this hardline position? I get saying it as a joke, but like, if you really mean it, you're going to go and vote for these people?
I mean, people are dying every day because of the current system that we have. People are going to keep dying. And I feel like all these presidential candidates believe in war. So it doesn't matter. No, like you said, it's all poop.
You know, they're all going to, you know, the foreign wars are going to continue. The drone bombings are going to continue.
Nothing's going to change.
The Federal Reserve banking cartel cabal is going to continue.
But they're going to edit
all of the audit. Yeah, well, that didn't happen.
Yeah, they're going to audit the Fed.
Healthcare and insurance companies are still going to own the country. There's still going to be nationalized education that's indoctrinating everyone for a decade and a half of their lives. You know, the major pillars of what's supporting contemporary American statism are going to be well intact. You might have a little bit of a expanded welfare state under this guy, or maybe a war with Russia with this guy, some tinkering at the edges. But, you know, even with, you know, Rand Paul or any of the other, you know, more, you know, radical choices, you know, we're not looking at like abolishing prisons. Abolishing police departments.
If I could end on one note, I just feel like in order for us to ever get a true look at the system, we need to look at war for what it is, and that is extreme violence. We need to look at this doomsday clock and realize, you know, you got 3 minutes to midnight. So anyone everywhere could just set off a nuke and just murder you in 2 seconds, and that's man. I mean, I feel like we need to look at war for what it is. This is murder.
War
this
is mass
violence.
Murder.
But if the state had wanted you to believe that, they would think that, you know, all these terrorist groups are going to be, you know, they're going to be the ones nukes. And that's why we got to keep control. And that's why we got to have a police state, because there might be some rogue terrorist with a suitcase nuke that's been sitting around for 20 years.
I wanted to offer something, respond to Anne's comment earlier. It reminds me of a quote by Voltaire where he says that,
Anne reminds me of Voltaire all the time.
Murder is wrong unless you do it in large numbers to the sounds of trumpets.
Very true.
Exactly.
Very, very true.
So before we go off air, can you tell us about where we can find you, if you're up to any blogs or whatever?
Yeah, what's going on with you guys? What's new?
I'm in the middle of trying to update alleyhavens.com.
You know, you said that a year ago on this show.
She did.
She did update it, actually.
He can attest that I updated the look of it. I haven't. Yeah, I could do more. I could do more. I'll bid that.
Okay. What about you, Mateus? Where can the world at large, the anarchist community, find you at?
I'm still pretty scattered. I can be found on Facebook. I can be found on Bitcoin.com sometimes. I can be found on Instagram, or I can be found on Tumblr. I can be found, you know, some of those are more secret.
You're on
than
Tumblr?
Others.
Well, Ali, I really hope, I know you didn't mention voice acting, but I hope you pursue it sometime in the
boom,
new future.
Look at the new site. It's
right
different.
Here, camera right here.
Aesthetically pleasing, that is.
It's very pleasing.
There you can find me on The Rebel Mistress on Facebook. Go ahead and like my page. I got a few audiobooks coming out soon.
Then you can find all of our content at rebelloveshow.com. Go subscribe to us on YouTube, iTunes, and Stitcher.
Peace.
Peace, guys. Peace out.
Peace.
What if the key to achieving liberty in your lifetime was to move together with